think sometimes, if we're not careful, we miss some really important words that at first glance might seem insignificant. Depending on your English translation, that first word in chapter 2, verse 9, is a significant link word. You may have a translation that says something like likewise, or like manner. Yeah, it's one word in the Greek, husautos. And what's happening is there's a connection. Remember in verse 8, we're talking about, I want the men in every place to pray with holy hands without wrath and dissension. Verse 9, likewise, I want gynaikos, women, to wear appropriate clothing with modesty and self-control. That's how they are to adorn themselves. And then he states in the negative, not in braided hair or gold or pearls or costly garments, verse 10, but rather by means of good works, as is proper for women making a claim to godliness. So the instructions for women in verses 9 and 10 parallel the instructions for men in the previous verse. And the link is not only the word likewise, but this principle or concept of holiness. Dress in a way that honors God. Pray in a way that honors God. Live in a way that honors God. And I don't think that this is limited to the assembly. As a matter of fact, if we keep reading, in chapter 3, verse 15, Paul says he's writing so that one will know how to conduct himself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, pillar and support of truth. I don't think Paul's saying, you know, what I'm saying about prayer and clothing and faith only applies when you've assembled together for worship. No. We're the called out church, whether we've assembled together or not. We carry that holiness with us. So, two thoughts here. You can wear too little or you can wear too much. Here's what I mean by that. It's pretty clear in the ancient world. You might remember even in Genesis 38 when Judah is betrayed by his daughter-in-law. She's dressed up like a harlot. He could easily identify her because of the way she dressed. We have other examples of that in Scripture. And it is true that especially in Corinth and Ephesus, these major urban areas, that it was easy to identify people of bad reputation, both male and female prostitutes and cultic religion. I mentioned last night the worship of Aphrodite involved male and female prostitutes, as did the worship of Dionysius, the god of love and the goddess of love and the god of wine. And worship was very popular of those gods, just like it would be in our world. And so sometimes you'll read a commentary and somebody will say, this is not about modesty like we think about modesty. Well, yeah, it is. Legion was naked he was immodest until Jesus healed him in Mark 5. And then we're told he was sitting clothed in his right mind. And I like to point out that right mind means you got clothes on. Right? It's a God-honoring mind. And I've got an 11-year-old daughter who's testing the waters, not because she's a bad child, but because she's looking around. She's aware. Mom, you know, so-and-so wore this. You know, Dad, so and some of you have been down that road, pray for us. So in part, this is tied to the attire of harlots. But this is also about ostentatious dress. It's not just that harlots are the only ones in that world who have braided hair or gold or pearls or costly garments. I think what Paul's saying, what God through Paul is saying, for males and females, we ought to be noticed for something other than our dress. 1 Peter 3, 1 through 6, Peter makes the same point to Christian women married to non-Christian men. It's not the outward appearance. It's who you are. It's your adornment as our sister in Christ or our brother in Christ. So You do not come to the assembly for a fashion show. There's a popular religious group in our area that teaches, you know, you can't wear makeup and you can't wear jewelry because of this verse. They've missed the point, with all due respect. What is being emphasized is holiness, just like in verse 8. Be modest. What does that mean? Don't wear too little, please, for my little girl. Don't wear too little. And my little boys. Don't wear too little. But also, don't put on a show with ostentatious apparel. Don't be known as that sister with the purse everybody wishes they had. Be known as that sister with that inner adornment of the heart that everybody wishes they had. And that sets the stage for what follows in verses 11 through 14, which is tied to the assembly. And the reason, for example, in verse 11 that you see the word silence there, I know people like to quabble, well, can they sing? You know, what does that mean? Silence here is an expression of submissiveness. Have there been chauvinist people who've abused this? Yes. Are there people who fail as men to lead in the way they ought to lead? Yes. Has this passage been misapplied and women been abused because of people that are not honoring to God? Yes. And all those things bother me and trouble me and are not God-honoring. But what Paul's saying, and the whole New Testament backs this up, every Christian lives in submissiveness to the will of God. And the comparison I think that's important to make here is, consider, and I'll try to be brief so we can get straight to the text here, but consider the equality of the Father and the Son. Jesus and the Father are both divine. They are intrinsically God. They are both worthy of our praise. They are both divine in every way. Jesus is not a lesser God. They are equal. But notice how in Jesus' earthly ministry, especially in John's Gospel, the farewell discourse of John 14 through 17, everything Jesus does is in submissiveness to the Father. Not my will, but your will be done. They're equal, but they're different. So the way I like to describe this to my little girls, although my 8-month-old isn't listening too much yet, but the way I describe this is, in Christ, it gives me no advantage to be male or female. We all have the opportunity to respond to God's grace through faith and be saved and be added to the church and forgiven of sin. But we have different jobs. We're equal, but we're different. We have different responsibilities. And so silence in verse 11 is tied to the principle of submission. And I do think that translations here are interesting, literally in silence, but the NIV says quietness. The ESV, New American Standard, says quietly, makes that an adverb. But then it gets more explicit in verse 12 when Paul says, I do not permit, and that's the language here, I do not allow a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man, but to be in silence or to remain quiet. So you've got this idea of quietness in verse 11 and quietness in verse 12. And even though in English translations those might look like two different words, in the Greek they are exactly the same. The prepositional phrase in verse 11 is exactly the same as it is in verse 12. And that's an example of, you know, as a teacher, if you want people to remember something, you repeat it. You repeat it. In silence. This is tied to the commandment of the Lord. This is tied to creation. And that's what verses 13 and 14 show. Adam was created first. Eve sinned first. Now, here's the thing about that. Yes, Eve sinned first, but Adam's failure is not only was he a poor leader, he played the blame game. We talked about this last night, how in Genesis 3, when Adam is confronted with his own sin, what does he do? This woman that you gave me, he blames Eve and he blames God. He does not accept responsibility at all for his actions. So, to make this a little bit more practical, You've got the prayer of men in verse 8, lifting holy hands. You've got the dress of women in verses 9 through 11. Be careful with elaborate hairstyles, extravagant clothing, other things that are immodest or inappropriate. Don't dress seductively, but put on good works. Wear good works, right? And then verses 12 through 15, there are three principles: learning, teaching, and exercising authority. A woman is to submit in the church as she does in the home. We have examples of this. For example, as with Mary, the sister of Lazarus, in Luke 10, 38 through 42. Then verse 12 sort of flips verse 11. Women are to learn in the assembly, but are not to take the lead in teaching. He doesn't say women can't teach. He just says that women can't teach men, Christian men, in formal church gatherings. And then exerting authority. Women are not to lead or govern in a congregation. And later on in the next chapter, when he starts talking about the qualifications of elders, the very first one is husband of one wife. It's going to be very difficult for a woman to meet that qualification. I'm not trying to be funny or flippant with that. So the idea of authority, headship, submission. Here's the thing. Gender roles in the church are tied to creation. They go all the way back to Genesis 2 and what it is that God designed for very beginning. The order that I pointed out last night in Genesis 2 that gets reversed in Genesis 3. You can look at examples in Scripture, especially in the ministry of Jesus, what he taught. And what you see is women have a valuable role in the ministry of Jesus as patronesses, supporters, disciples. They're there at the cross. They're there at the empty tomb. But they are not apostles. They are not leaders in the assembly. Even women who are prophetesses, like Huldah or Deborah or Miriam in the Old Testament, or the daughters of Philip in the New Testament, they use that gift, but not in the assembly. And that's one reason why Paul has to challenge that. And I think we might say, yeah, the culture's changed. No, I pointed this out last night. I think those women in Corinth were under a lot of pressure to act like the women who were worshiping Aphrodite, who were the objects of worship, because sex in the cultic prostitute area was viewed as worship. And so just imagine the pressure these God-fearing women are under counterculturally to not act like that in the way they dress and the way they act in the assembly, what they're known for. Now, I want us to chew on this, but before we do, verse 15. Verse 15 often kind of gets overlooked and abused. I want to be as literal in working through this verse as possible. At the beginning of verse 15, you have a future passive verb. She will be saved. Okay, so that's as literal as we can be. Through childbearing, or through the bearing of a child. If, and now it shifts to plural. I hope your English translation shows that. The beginning of verse 15 is singular. Now, it might be that your English translation provides in the plural, like the New American Standard, I think, messes up here. They supply the word women in italics, categorically. But in the Greek, she will be saved through the bearing of a child, singular, if they, now it shifts to the plural, which most English translations are going to show, if they continue or might abide in faith and love and sanctification with self-control. And the last part of that is where English translations go wild. It's literally sophrosthenes, which is self-control. It's how the ESV renders this. King James is good here with the ASV, sobriety. New American Standard, self-restraint. NIV, propriety. RSV, modesty. Holman Christian Standard Bible, good sense. It's hard to beat self-control or self-restraint or sobriety. So here's how I've heard this interpreted. And I'm not saying this is right. You need to be in submission in the assembly. And notice nothing said about husbands here, because not every woman's married. And you do have a lot of widows. We're going to get to that in chapter 5. This is a principle that's not dependent upon marriage. But I've heard verse 15 taken the mean. Well, you need to be in submissiveness, but at least you can still have children, and that's how you're going to find value as a Christian. That's about as wrong an interpretation as possible. And here's why. Notice that in the previous context, nothing is said about family. Nothing said about marriage. Nothing is said about husbands. Nothing. The only thing that's even close to talking about family is the example of Adam and Eve in Genesis 2, which is a record of a historical account of what happened in the garden, right? And so to suddenly flip the switch in verse 15 and say, well, you know, your purpose and value as a woman is found in bearing children. Okay, so I hope you can get married and have children. Because if not, you don't have value. And so to twist verse 15 and use it as a reason to say, you know, women have got to stay at home and have a bunch of children to have value, we're going to get to the home question later in 1 Timothy. This isn't the place where it really should be addressed. It's just a problem. Now, here's my suggestion, and this is all this is, and you can say that's great, or you can say that's, the Greek word for that idea is balone, and we're going to challenge that. But I would like to propose that we interpret verse 15 in light of verse 14, the context. What's he been talking about in verse 12, 13, and 14?
The general woman, the you, not the specific, Eve, as indicated by the article B.
Yeah, creation, right, Eve, Adam and Eve. We've been looking in verses 12 through 14 at Adam and Eve, right? What happened with creation, the order of creation and sin. And clearly everything here is tied to sin. What about this idea? Eve is responsible for falling into transgression and being deceived. That's verse 14. Everybody see what I'm saying? Verse 15, but she also brings salvation into the world. Could it be that this is a reference to the birth of the Christ? The birth of the Messiah? Because, again, she will be saved. And that's why I think, I like the New American Standard, but boy, it butchers it here. And a few other places, too. I can point out mistakes in any translation, but this is one here in the New American Standard. Because it makes it sound like, you know, women will be preserved through the bearing of children. Well, wait a second. She will be saved or preserved through the bearing of a child. Not only is she singular, a child is singular. And so when you read the New American Standard in verse 15, how are you supposed to see that? Does anybody have a translation that makes the noun she and the child singular at the beginning of the verse? Because in the Greek, that's what it is. And it sometimes gets hidden because what do translators assume? We're talking about women.
Everybody. All women.
When I think we're talking about a woman.
Eve.
And then what happens is, okay, for the first verse of the verse, the first part of the verse, she will be saved for the bearing of a child, which is predictive about Eve. Now, here's an application in the plural. Notice that the second half of verse 15 says nothing about children. It says, if they abide in faith and love and sanctification with self-control. And so to tie a physical childbearing in the first half of verse 15 and a spiritual disposition in the second half of verse 15 really, for lack of a better expression, messes up what the verse is saying. And it leaves couples and women who desire children with all of their heart, soul, mind, and strength but cannot physically have children to feel like you're not valuable when you can choose to stay single and still have great value in the kingdom of God, i.e. John the Baptist, Jesus, Paul, and a few other women. Now, culturally, most women marry, and most women desire children in the world of Jesus, but that's not tied necessarily to their own desire. It's tied to a patriarchal society where, with a few exceptions, like Lydia in Acts 16, who's a wealthy businesswoman, you need a man in that culture to be successful. But I would just appeal to you that verse 15 ought to be, it's sort of like the 1 Peter 3 thing and spirits in prison. If we disconnect that from the setting of Noah, we've got all kinds of headaches. If we try to talk about purgatory and create all this crazy talk about the end times and disconnect it from in the days of Noah, well, all of a sudden, it's like H.G. Wells all of a sudden in 1 Peter, Yes, sir. You've been patient.
My word saved here must not mean spiritually saved. I'm not sure.
I would say what's being said is she gives birth to, it's like the genealogy of Luke 3, to the Christ. She's saved through the bearing of a child, namely Jesus.
What I'm saying, I'm going to suggestion you can compute. And what does the word saved mean in your translations? That particular saved.
Sozo, the verb I save, does not always allude to a spiritual salvation. It can be, I was choking and you gave me the Heimlich and saved me. But here I think it is talking about salvation. And it is talking about Jesus.
Okay, so here's something a little bit contrasting.
Yeah.
What I'm not saying I'm right, but it's a suggestion. Now we're talking about the position of the man, the woman, and the church. Even when it goes into Adam and Eve, Adam first. And the woman, she can't teach, she can't do this, she can't do that. But when she brings a child into earth, now she becomes A1 teacher, A1 instructor, the main. There are so many Bible characters that had such strong mothers that taught them and raised them.
Right.
And I suggest maybe that's what they're talking about there.
Well, and I think you're right that to miss the value of motherhood in Scripture would be a great mistake. I don't want to do that. I would just humbly offer two thoughts. Women can do things in the church. It's just that they can't exercise authority in the assembly, or else there's no reason to say she's to receive instruction or she's to adorn herself with good works, including women that aren't mothers, including women who aren't married. And I think the problem in verse 15, however you take saved, whether it's spiritual, which I would argue it is, as you, I think, would suggest, that, okay, I'm going to just speak for Paul for a minute, if I can use slang. Before you get discouraged about what I've just said about creation, and men, before you start piling on these women because of what Eve did, and by the way, if you know Genesis 3, you can't do that because Adam's not exactly squeaky clean here. He fails as much, if not more, than she does. Let me remind you what else Eve's responsible for. And seeing the way that New Testament writers highlight Eve as the mother of all living, highlight her role from the very beginning along with Adam, not as frequently as Adam. Adam's all over Romans 5 and several other places, but generally Adam's in the negative and Eve's in the positive, except here. So I would say, this is an area where people can disagree and it's not a make or break situation. But my problem with taking verse 15 to mean that if you're a mama, you can be saved, and here's the reason you have value. Is instruction that's given to God-fearing women that are not married, women that are not mamas. And so if we connect it to the context of what precedes it, I would be of the opinion that this, she leads into sin, but she also brings salvation into the world.
It's interesting, you pointed out that it says that Eve is the mother of all living, even after she sinned. I mean, that's after she sinned there.
And you know, they're described as being made in the image of God in Genesis 1:26-28, and in Genesis 9 after sin. So it's not like sin takes away our being made in the image of God, although Jesus is described as an exact representation of the image of God in the New Testament in a way that perhaps is not as evident among us anymore because of sin. But I would suggest that you're right, and that this could be a way for Paul to prevent chauvinism. Paul's accused of being, and this is, we alluded to this last night, people, well, that's Paul and that's not Jesus. Well, there's continuity in the ministry of Jesus and Paul, and to pit one against the other is foolish. It goes against the nature of Scripture and the nature of this type of communication.
It seems to me that if we want to put women in a role of being second class almost, we just need to remember that a woman brought our Savior into this world.
I think that's exactly what Paul's saying here.
I think I'm starting to see that when times and verses all in like that.
What is the antecedent of the plural pronoun there, they?
Ooh, man. Thank you for using the word antecedent.
Doesn't that go back to the men and women? The men and women that he's talking about previously in that chapter?
What's the antecedent of which word?
They.
They.
The plural.
The pronoun has an antecedent.
Yeah, if they.
It's not in verse 15.
It is in, it, well, I'm reading the King James, and it says, if they continue. Right.
Yeah, which is.
So it seems to me it's talking about the men and women that he is addressing and instructing them in the kind of behavior that they need to have. And this is the way that we are saved through Christ who came through Eve.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea because gune in verse 14, the woman, is singular. And the last plural reference we've had to men or women was all the way back in verse 8. So usually if there's an antecedent, it's got to be of the same number. So it's got to be plural since the word in verse 15 is plural. So I do think this is a good word of caution. She brings the Savior into the world, but we all, which is the language of verses 1 through 7 in this chapter, if we continue or abide in faith, love, and sanctification with self-control, we'll be saved. So it's not just the fact that, and this is, I wish we talked more about Mary. I think one of the reasons we don't is because obviously Catholicism has elevated her to a position that she did not want as the mother of God. But when you think about her song in Luke 2, the Magnificat, and her disposition, being the mama of Jesus did not save Mary. Recognizing he was her Savior and living in obedience saved Mary. Think about what that required of Mary. And that's a bit of a rabbit, but I've just always struggled with taking verse 15 to randomly refer to women having children when she will be saved through the bearing of a child. And this is a place where if we don't compare translations, if all I have is the New American Standard, I would be really confused here because it's really bad the way they translate the first half of this verse. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The reference that I have here is childbirth mentioned here refers to the birth of Jesus Christ. Women and men are saved spiritually because of the most important birth, that of the Christ himself.
I love that. Is that the ESV study Bible? Most of the time, it's pretty good. You know, Wayne Jackson, he's living in Jackson, Tennessee now, about 30 minutes from me. In the Christian Courier, wrote a review of the ESV study Bible and pointed out some places. Wayne Grudem, I know he's a friend. He is the chief editor of the ESV, and he is a staunch Calvinist. And so there are some places where the commentary in the ESV study Bible on baptism is really squirrely, but that is a beautiful statement. And I think it speaks to what you've said about the antecedent, which is a good point. You know, most of the time when I study this, I'm thinking antacid, but antecedent is a better word.
Well, I
gotta get on the elders.
All pronouns have an antecedent, they refer to something else.
Yes, sir.
And if it is a plural, what Rick brought up.
It's gotta be a plural.
It has to refer to something that's plural. Well, there's no definite plural.
Right.
You have to take, and he's talking about men and he's talking about women. There's your two plural things that the pronoun they refers back to.
You gotta have a plural or you have to have two singulars.
That's right.
And I think that's what we have here. And the point is, again, let me recommend a book if you wanna read more on the role, the gender role discussion. This is written by a very conservative, he's not a member of the church, but it's the best book on gender role questions from the text of the New Testament I've ever read. It's short, so I like that too. It's titled Equal Yet Different. Equal Yet Different, and it's written by a guy named Alexander Stroh. Alexander, he looks like Straw. Stroh. And by the way, he's also written a book titled Biblical Eldership. That's one of the best books on elderships I've ever read, and a book on deacons. When I was first put in as a deacon, I read that book because I want to be serious in that service. Strauch. I can't write in English anymore very well. Yes, sir.
I'm so glad you didn't say men are from Mars and women are from Venus. Emotional intelligence. Or something.
That's a lie. That's in the. And I think that's what we have to be aware of. You know, one of the reasons why there's a battle of the sexes is sin. Genesis 3 makes it clear that our desire to compete with each other. I'm just going to put this out there. Neither chauvinism nor feminism honors God. What honors God is seeing the roles that we've been given and loving the Lord and wanting to be fully committed to Him. And I'll tell you, if it weren't for the faiths of some women in my life, I would not be a Christian. And I'm a preacher's son. And I know of some congregations that would be dead and closed if it weren't for faithful women who kept going when their husbands weren't doing what they needed to do. So if you've heard me suggest somehow, directly or indirectly, that women are less valuable, I have misspoken. We all have the same value, and I think Galatians 3:28 brings that balance here. But value is not necessarily tied to job. Here's how a philosopher, a friend of mine, says this. We are intrinsically equal, but instrumentally different. We're all valuable in the same way in the eyes of God. We have different responsibilities and jobs, just like the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
The most recent installment of the Fulton County Gospel News is on the role of men and women in the church, and I wrote Good. Gender roles based on Galatians 3:28. So just a quick plug there.
Good.
Anybody with the internet can pull that up too.
That's great, and that's free.
Yeah.
Right. Good.
Yep.
Yeah, thank you. It's poor. It's thick. Okay, so elders in 10 minutes. Let's get it. Chapter 3. Thank y'all. Good. Can we stay another hour tonight? I just have a hotel room.
Sure.
My neighbors are really loud. I have a visiting. I love the hotel, Jeremy. I'm not complaining. But there is a visiting ladies baseball team from Louisiana. I'm pretty sure they were taking batting practice in the hallway. And I tried to review them in kindness, but didn't work. So, I'll stay all night. Let's do it. Hey, we'll wrap up. I'll drive home in the morning. Great. Be locking. Elders and deacons. Now, what I'd like to suggest we do is let's read the text, verses 1 through 7. And I've got the Greek here, and I'll be glad to interact with that. But I want to put these qualifications in five categories and talk about them in a practical fashion first, because I don't want to miss the forest for the trees, okay? So 1 Timothy 3, I'm going to keep reading from this erroneous New American Standard. Verse 15 really disappointed me, but I think they do a good job in chapter 2. And I'll just say again, if you're building your theological foundation on the perfection of an English translation, Find a new foundation, read comparatively. Jesus is the foundation anyway, I think. But chapter 3, starting in verse 1. It's a trustworthy statement. If any man aspires to the office of overseer, it is a fine work he desires to do. An overseer, then, must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, temperate, prudent, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, verse 3, not addicted to wine or pugnacious, but gentle, peaceable, free from the love of money. He must be one who manages his own household well, keeping his children under control with all dignity. But if a man does not know how to manage his own household, how will he take care of the church of God? And verse 6, not a new convert, so that he will not become conceited and fall into the condemnation incurred by the devil. He must have a good reputation with those outside the church, so that he will not fall into reproach in the snare of the devil. Let me just quickly point out that the first statement in chapter 3, it is a faithful saying or a trustworthy saying. You might recognize, we saw that back in chapter 1. 1 Timothy, and pointed this out last night, how it occurs frequently. Let's see, where was that?
15.
Thank you. Chapter 1, verse 15. It's a trustworthy or faithful saying. We're going to see that 3 more times in 1 Timothy. And so what he's saying here is, this is what we know to be true. This is a true statement, and this is about church order. Paul, we have no indication that Paul was an elder. We have no indication that Paul ever married. Peter is an elder. 1 Peter 5, 1 through 4, fellow elder is the language used there. We know Peter had a mother-in-law, and that's part of the package if you get married. So she got sick and Jesus healed her. Now, when you look at this, let me talk about the 5 big categories. And I want you to know, I borrowed this from Earl Edwards. His leadership in the church class was a good class back in the day. And so I want to cite my sources. And this material with regard to these categories is from Brother Earl Edwards. There's the reputation requisite of verse 7. What are we told about his reputation? What does his reputation need to be? I'm sorry, I said verse 7. Well, I'm kind of skipping around. What do we learn about his reputation in verse 7?
Good report. Good report.
A good report, a good reputation. With who?
Those that are without.
Those outside the church. Remember I mentioned last night the church that put something in the newspaper? They said, we've got these 2 men that we want to appoint as elders. Do you know any reason why they ought not be able to lead our church? Woo! That's testing verse 7 pretty well. Why is that important?
Evangelism, love for souls, Christian conduct and example.
Exactly. And if they aren't respected by outsiders, are they going to be respected by insiders? Let's say that the congregation is unaware that this gentleman at work is a tyrant and has a foul mouth and is greedy and harsh. And they find out he's an elder down at the so-and-so church. Not good. Reputation. Then, the domestic requisite. There are a couple of things pointed out here. Notice in verse 2, he is to be the husband of one wife. Literally, in the Greek, a one-woman man. This verse obviously prohibits polygamy, which was alive and well in the first century and still is in parts of Utah, sadly. This verse also prohibits unscriptural marriages and speaks to an obligation a man has to his wife and family. If he's had a scriptural divorce, I would say that's in a different category. But he's not to have more than one living wife. He also needs to manage his own family well. This is also repeated in Titus 1, verse 6. Now, I'm going to just say some things and let you react to this as you choose, but I don't think this is about his ability to reproduce. I think if his children are adopted, he's still qualified and they're faithful. It's about this elder's experience in the home. If He's been successful leading his own family. He's better equipped to lead the church family. That's the language of verse 5, is it not? So what does it mean here? I think his wife needs to be faithful. That's a part of his household. The wives of elders need to be exemplary Christians and can be a great help in the work, although he's the elder. There's no shelter in the church. And her behavior will impact the reputation of the congregation as an elder's wife. But then you go to the children that are mentioned in verses 4 and 5 and in Titus 1, verse 6. And so you must ask, if his children obey him with a proper respect, are they faithful to the Lord? Meaning, are they Christians? They need to be both faithful to their father, little f, and faithful to their father, capital F. They're old enough to resist the immorality and to embrace the Christian life, meaning they're baptized, which means that children need to be old enough to believe and to have demonstrated faithfulness after baptism. This raises all kinds of questions about should all the children be faithful, and you'll find all kinds of responses to this. I had a fellow the other day challenge me, if a man had 5 kids and 3 are faithful, that's 60%. And so I would suggest to you that the ideal is, even if those children are grown and gone and out of the house, their faith is still an expression of what they were taught earlier in life. And so you look for leaders whose kids, even if they're old enough to have left home, are still walking in faithfulness. I think it would be very difficult if a family came to an elder and said, we're struggling, our son has lost his faith and has left the church. Now, the elder might have been through something like that and helped bring his children back to faith before the elder said, yeah, my kid left the faith a long time ago. The ideal here, and based on the language itself, would be for that wife to be faithful to the Lord, which I think means she's attending, she's participating, she's exemplifying the Christian faith, and for those kids, whether they're at home or grown, to be faithful as well. So that's the domestic requisite. Then we talk about experience. Look at verse 6. What do we learn about his experience in verse 6? What kind of experience does the elder need? Not a novice, not a new convert. Literally, not newly planted. Which means he's seasoned in the faith. I don't think it's a requirement that he be a deacon first, but maybe if he has been, that's been a good training ground. There's nothing said here about how long he needs to have been a Christian before he's an elder. Brother Edwards suggested 8 to 10 years. Well, that's a good suggestion, but I can't find that. That might vary depending upon the individual. Can't be a novice, yes, sir.
If it has to be 8 to 10 years, how do we justify the fact that on Paul's second missionary journey, he appointed elders?
I think it's a good question, and I think it's due to the fact that you have elders in Judaism who aren't novices because they've already... I think what he was saying is, if somebody doesn't know the Lord and doesn't know anything about his will, but again, I would not put a number on that. It's kind of like someone asked me recently, how old do you need to be to obey the Lord? The question is not how old, the question is what do you need to know? Because the number could vary depending on the person. But notice how we're building reputation, domestic background, experience, ability. Look at verses 3, I'm sorry, not, I've gotten verse 2, and then I'm going to pull in something from Titus 1 that I think is important here. He must be able to teach. Verse 2, he must be able to teach or apt to teach. Why does he need to be able to teach? It's not just about study. What does Acts 20, verse 28 suggest that an elder ought to be able to do? Be on the guard, to defend the flock. And so in order to refute false teachers, in order to feed the flock. And then Titus 1:9, I wish we could just put both of these texts up for us and compare them. Titus 1:9, we're talking about the qualifications of elders. Holding fast the faithful word, which is in accordance with the teaching, so that he will be able both to exhort in sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict. I think that's the unpacking, if you will, of verse 2 in 1 Timothy 3. And then one more. We've mentioned reputation. We've mentioned experience. We've mentioned domestic requisites. We've mentioned ability. And we've not even gotten to the one that gets the most time in 1 Timothy 3. Character. There are at least, according to my count, 8 things said about his character. He must be above reproach or blameless. Doesn't mean he's perfect, but what does that mean? He sees he's in the wrong. What's he going to do? Make it right. It doesn't mean he'll never be blamed, but that those accusations are not tied to anything that's real. He must be temperate or peaceable. Some translations there say self-controlled or disciplined. Means that he's quick to hear and slow to speak. He's not going to make snap decisions. He's not going to be inappropriate in sexual conduct. He's going to be chaste and modest. He's not violent or a brawler. He doesn't ball up the fist and threaten violence. He's not contentious. He's respectable. I like the King James rendering in verse 2 of 1 Timothy 3. Of good behavior. Literally, he has a well-ordered life. Verse 2 also says he's hospitable. The word there, philoxenon, in Greek means a lover of strangers. Elders need to love people and love to help people, meaning that we're sensitive to others and strive to meet needs. Verse 3, he must not be given to much wine. Alcohol can easily be abused and lead to lots of problems. And I think in a culture like ours, where millions of people are addicted and see the destruction alcohol brings on in our lives, elders ought not touch it. Verse 3, he must not be a lover of money or pursue dishonest gain. I like the King James, not greedy of filthy lucre. Wealth is not his primary concern. He gets money honestly and uses money honestly. Now, Titus adds 2 more. Titus 1:7, he must not be arrogant. Sometimes translated overbearing or self-willed. He's a part of an eldership. There's no head elder. There's no single pastor. That's not the way the Lord's church was meant to function, and that will lead only to resentment among the eldership and among the congregation. And finally, Titus 1, verses 3 and 8, he must be holy, upright, and a lover of good. He's found in healthy environments. He uses his free time wisely. He's just and upright. He's fair. He's a holy man. That's a tall order. But you know, in some ways, other than the domestic requisites, everything we just described is something we all ought to desire.
These are Christian qualifications.
They really are, other than the domestic requisites. They are. The other 4, reputation and character and experience and even what's said, whatever I left out, ability. Those are all things we should all strive for, but I said this the other day, I don't remember where I said it, but I think it's true. The only thing worse than a congregation having no elders is a congregation having elders that aren't qualified to be elders. And I think that we've got to really be prayerful and thoughtful and sober about this, because it's going to impact the flock in a positive way if you've got godly men leading who meet these qualifications. And this is not an elder for life. I mean, it might be that I meet these qualifications today, but 10 years from now, I don't. And I think this is something that, you know, if I were an elder, and I'm obviously not, but I would want to evaluate this carefully, prayerfully, continually, all the time. What do you think about that? Did we touch on anything that you want to discuss, or?
I got a question. Do you think, could we use these qualifications for a Jewish elder at the time, or would it be different, or do we know?
We just don't know. We don't have enough about the qualifications of elders in Israel. But I would say that just like everything else we see moving from the old covenant to the better covenant, these qualifications are better. These qualifications have been fulfilled by Jesus, and we're talking about something. I do think there's continuity, or we wouldn't see what happens in Acts happen so quickly. If you want to see a really neat word study of the three nouns that are used to describe elders, Acts 20, when Paul's saying goodbye to the Ephesian elders at Miletus, tearfully, all three words for elder are used in one passage. And I love using this when I'm trying not to be a Greek geek. But in Acts 20, starting at verse 17, and depending on your English translation, you know, I like to make notes in my Bible, and if you'd like to circle words and make notes, you might make note of this. Look at Acts 20, verse 17. Does your translation use the word elders there?
Yes.
Called to him the elders of the church. That is the word presbyteros. It means someone who's older. And obviously an elder is someone who's older, someone who's experienced. Then look down at verse 28. You get the other two words. Be on your guard. Be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. You may have a translation that renders that word differently there.
Yeah, you know, the American Standard says bishops.
Okay, it's the word episkopos that means an administrator or an overseer or someone who's in a position of authority to make decisions. That's what we often highlight, right? Be with the elders as we make decisions. Well, they're doing more than making decisions, but they are making decisions. And then the next word, to shepherd, it's actually a verb, but it's based on the same root, poimenos. So elders are presbyteros, episkopos, poimenos. They're older, wise men who make decisions and oversee the flock, and they shepherd the flock. And so if you've got an eldership that's like a board of directors and they don't know the church, or you've got an eldership that knows the church, but they don't make decisions, there's imbalance there. And the three words that are used in Acts 20, verse 17 and 28, really, I think, encapsulate nicely for us what elders do and who elders are.
Are these words used in the Septuagint also?
There is the Hebrew. The Old Testament was originally written in Hebrew, and around 190 BC in Alexandria, Egypt, it was translated, the Old Testament was translated into Greek, because most people spoke Greek and read Greek. And it seems that most New Testament writers quote from the Greek Old Testament, the Septuagint, or as Dr. Rogers calls it, the Septuagint, instead of the Hebrew Bible. And so the thing about these words is presbyteros, for example, sometimes it's used just to describe older people. It's like, we're going to get into this, but the word for deacon, diakonos, we transliterated that word, meaning that, I say we, somebody took the Greek word, I shouldn't have used red, sorry. The car wash. Somebody took the Greek word and they transliterated it. Delta is D. Iota alpha is E. I'll put an A there. Kappa is C. Omicron is O. Nu is N. Deacon. Just like baptism, just like evangelism, in other words, that we've transliterated rather than translated. Well, sometimes this is translated servant, minister, and at other times it's clearly referring to an office or a job. So context is what helps us to know. Well, there are older people that aren't elders, and there are servants that aren't deacons. Think about it this way. Every elder is an older person, and every deacon is a servant. but not every older person is an elder and not every servant is a deacon. And so there's some confusion here, but so every time you see shepherd, it might be a literal shepherd. You know, and it might be David tending Jesse's lambs, not an elder. The only word that I think is exclusive for elders is episkopos in the New Testament. The other two could just describe older people, seasoned Christians, right? Senior saints, or a literal shepherd. But this is a more balanced way, I think, to describe their work.
Just for the sake of fairness before we break, there's also the view that elders ruling their own household has to do with children in the home. And to hold that man responsible for what a free moral agent does when they're out of his care and out of his view and out of his influence to a large extent would not disqualify that man to serve as an elder in the congregation. So there's the stricter interpretation and the one that's a little bit maybe looser or more broad.
Yeah.
And there's, you know, quite a bit of discussion and debate right. about this. There's two ways of looking at that.
That's right. And that can be said for a lot of things. And, you know, there are good arguments on both sides of that. I think the Greek speaks to the position I would take on that more, but I appreciate you pointing that out. That's a good point.
I would say no matter which we adhere to, one yeah. adheres to, an elder had better be a servant.
That's right. Servant leadership.
And that better be all he wants to be. He better.
Yeah.
I'm speaking very dictatorial. But an elder that doesn't view himself in the same way that the Apostle Paul viewed his apostleship, and that was as a servant.
Yeah.
It makes no difference if his children's faithful as when they're old or whether they're faithful. Yeah. He doesn't need to be an elder.
That's a good point. And there are men whose children are faithful after they leave home. I've heard people say, well, it'd be impossible. I don't believe that that's necessarily true. But let's take a break and we'll come back and cover a chapter and a half. Thanks so much for some good discussion.